Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. Welcome to Part 1 of a complete guide to SpaceX's webcasts. Today, we're going to run you through a crash course on SpaceX's current and upcoming rockets, explain the different launch and landing pads, and also ensure you that those clouds of smoke pouring out of the rocket before the launch are perfectly normal. By the end of the series, hopefully you'll acquire all the knowledge necessary to have a pretty good grasp on all the cool things happening during these launches. Let's get started.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff!
SpaceX truly has made a name for themselves, not only by doing mind-blowing things with their rockets, but also by bringing us along for their launches in really well-produced live webcasts. They've changed the game on what kind of access we all expect when it comes to a rocket launch. Now, when we watch non-SpaceX rocket launches, they can be downright boring. First things first, let's lay a little groundwork. For those of you that don't know, SpaceX is a private rocket and spacecraft company started in 2002 by PayPal and Tesla founder Elon Musk. But don't let a private rocket company fool you. These aren't some backyard bottle rockets or anything. These are some of the biggest and most powerful rockets currently flying. Not only that, SpaceX has figured out how to autonomously land and reuse the first stage of their rockets with a very high degree of accuracy and success, something that no one else has been able to do with an orbital-class rocket. If you want to know more about how SpaceX lands, or why them landing is a big deal, or perhaps you need a basic rocket vocabulary lesson before continuing, I've got you covered. Since their humble beginnings, SpaceX's pace has picked up drastically. Going from only a handful of launches per year to currently launching almost every 2 weeks, they're on pace to do more launches per year than all other US competitors, plus all launches out of Russia combined. So there are plenty of opportunities to catch SpaceX launch live on their webcasts at youtube.com/SpaceX or SpaceX.com. And don't forget, you can even catch a launch live in person, which I'll talk more about later in another video. Next ground rule we should lay down is how to know when SpaceX is going to launch so you can catch them live. Of course, by following SpaceX and Elon Musk on Twitter, you'll get plenty of updates. But if you want to see a full up-to-date launch manifest, I highly recommend going to reddit.com/r/SpaceX and check out their sidebar, or visiting spaceflightnow.com and clicking on launch schedules. Then, there's even an app you can download called Launch Alarm that can notify you of upcoming launches. And don't forget, I host live streams of SpaceX launches whenever I can, so join me live whenever there's a launch and ask me any questions you might have. So now you know when a launch is going to happen, here's what you're going to see when you pull up their live stream. First off, they start the webcast about 20 to 30 minutes before their intended launch time with SpaceX Radio. This is just their logo and music by the artist Test Shot Starfish, a duo based out of LA who also founded the multimedia production company Subtractive. About 10 to 20 minutes before T-0, we'll see a cool promo intro video that always gets me really pumped. Then, we typically see a quick shot of the rocket and the host, who will be there to update us on what the mission is and any other update on the launch. We've seen a slew of hosts in the past and different formats, but lately, as of summer 2017, they seem to have mostly settled on airing about 10 minutes before liftoff and having a single host give a simple rundown. One quick note, all of their hosts are actual full-time employees and engineers at SpaceX, and they're not just talking heads. Pretty cool, right? Now back over to that shot of the rocket sitting on the pad waiting to launch. First, let's talk about the different rockets you may see SpaceX launch. As of the summer of 2017, SpaceX is only launching one type of rocket, their two-stage Falcon 9. The Falcon 9, which first launched in 2010, has since been launched 38 times, making it their workhorse vehicle. Some future rockets we hope to see come online soon are their long-awaited Falcon Heavy and their next-generation rocket that will be the biggest rocket to ever fly, the BFR, or Big Falcon Rocket, otherwise known as ITS, the Interplanetary Transportation System. If it turns out anything like Falcon Heavy, which has been just 6 months away since 2013, I wouldn't hold my breath too much for the BFR to launch pre-2022, as we're currently led to believe. Now, back to Falcon Heavy. It's basically three Falcon 9 rockets strapped together to make a heavy-class rocket with almost as much thrust at liftoff as the historic Saturn V moon rocket. We should actually see it on a launch pad by the end of 2017. Whether or not it flies in 2017 is to be seen, but the hardware for it has been spotted in the wild many times. We're basically waiting for SpaceX to fix one of their launch pads in Florida so they can convert their current launch pad to support Falcon Heavy. Prior to the Falcon 9, SpaceX first developed a much smaller rocket known as Falcon 1. This vehicle only had one Merlin engine on its first stage as opposed to the 9 Merlin engines we see on the Falcon 9. The second stage had a small vacuum-optimized engine known as the Kestrel engine, which was only used on the Falcon 1. The first Falcon 1 launched on May 24, 2006, but was unsuccessful after an engine failure at T plus 33 seconds. The next two attempts at flying Falcon 1 were also unsuccessful. But on September 28, 2008, Falcon 1 Flight 4 succeeded to become the first privately funded and developed liquid propellant rocket to reach orbit. Following another successful launch, the Falcon 1 was retired as SpaceX pursued their Falcon 9. The success of Falcon 1 was crucial for SpaceX to secure contracts. The Falcon 1 launched from a small launch pad in Kwajalein, Marshall Islands, which is in the middle of the Pacific Ocean and has remained unused since 2009. Speaking of launch pads, let's talk about which launch pads you can expect to see being used today. Let's start in order with where the Falcon 9 had its inaugural launch. On June 4th, 2010, SpaceX launched their first Falcon 9 from Space Launch Complex 40 at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Cape Canaveral, Florida. Now, we often hear people refer to this whole area as Kennedy Space Center, but technically, Cape Canaveral is just adjacent to Kennedy Space Center, which is on Merritt Island, separated only by a small causeway. This is a funny technicality, but you can spot the difference when you hear SLC, or SLC, for Space Launch Complex compared to just LC for Launch Complex. SLC denotes the launch pad is on the Air Force side, while LC denotes the launch pad is at Kennedy Space Center. Fun fact for the day, you'll recognize SLC 40 by its four large lightning towers and its relatively flat and simple design. SLC 40 is the site of the vast majority of SpaceX launches. To date, 27 out of the 39 flights have taken place here. Launches from SLC 40 are going to either be heading to low Earth orbit, such as those heading to the International Space Station, a geostationary orbit, or perhaps a sun-synchronous orbit. While we're talking about SLC 40, as of the making of this video, SLC 40 is still offline after being completely destroyed. On September 1st, 2016, a composite overwrap pressure vessel, or COPV, exploded inside the second stage, which caused an entire loss of the vehicle and its $200 million payload, the AMOS-6 satellite. This pad anomaly happened while fueling up a Falcon 9 for a pre-flight dress rehearsal of an upcoming launch. SpaceX always holds the rockets down and performs what's called a static fire of their rockets before launches to ensure all systems are in perfect working order. SLC 40 is expected to return online by late summer 2017. The next launch pad SpaceX got online and launched from is out of Vandenberg Air Force Base in Central California. SpaceX acquired launch pad SLC-4 in 2011, and on September 28, 2013, SpaceX launched their first Falcon 9 for the Cassio mission into a polar orbit. You'll easily recognize Vandenberg by its beautiful hilly landscape, but don't be fooled by its beauty. Every launch I've been to at Vandenberg looks like this. Expect either insanely dense fog or the most beautiful launch you'll ever see. Due to its location, all launches from Vandenberg head southward and are almost always on some form of polar orbit or an occasional sun-synchronous orbit. Polar orbits are generally not as common as the others previously mentioned, so to date there have only been four launches from Vandenberg. This is bound to change as in the near future, SpaceX will be launching and maintaining an upcoming global internet satellite constellation that may see several launches out of Vandenberg per year. Vandenberg is also designed to be able to accommodate Falcon Heavy when it goes online. The most recent launch pad SpaceX acquired and activated is historic Launch Complex 39A in Kennedy Space Center, Florida. Yes, you will almost always hear the words historic in front of 39A. Why? Well, this is the launch pad that humans left Earth from to go to the moon. As a matter of fact, every launch to the moon was launched from 39A, as well as a majority of the space shuttle launches. So, by all accounts, it is fair to call it historic. SpaceX officially leased 39A on April 14th, 2014, a day I remember very well, because I was there! My first time doing photography for Spaceflight Now would happen to allow me the opportunity to catch the signing of the lease of 39A. Yes, I even got a selfie with SpaceX President Gwynne Shotwell. 39A is easily recognizable by the remains of the Space Shuttle Fixed Service Structure, or FSS, and Rotating Service Structure, RSS, which were last used on the final Space Shuttle launch mission STS-135 on July 8, 2011. Although SpaceX has heavily modified the pad, they've been slow to dismantle the large rotating service structure as it doesn't hinder their capability to launch, but it is being slowly dismantled. The fixed service structure, on the other hand, will remain and function as their new crew access tower, where future astronauts will ride the elevator and climb inside a Dragon 2 capsule sitting on top of a Falcon 9, or maybe a Falcon Heavy. The FSS also houses a 24.4 meter, 80 foot tall, lightning mast, which provides lightning protection to the vehicle and the pad. You'll also notice on the outer perimeter a very large horizontal integration facility with SpaceX written in large letters. This building is large enough to house 5 cores at once, which is a good thing since SpaceX has been landing so many first stages, they've been utilizing every square inch to store them all. This also means it's big enough to bring together the 3 cores necessary to assemble their mighty Falcon Heavy. SpaceX first launched from 39A on February 19th, 2017. Since then, they've managed to do 8 launches in just 6 months. History will know it was fortunate that SpaceX had been preparing 39A for launches since 2015, so when the AMOS 6 anomaly happened just some 6 kilometers or 3.5 miles away, they were almost ready to go online with 39A, shortening their stand-down time drastically. Once Pad 40 is operational by late summer 2017, they'll resume Falcon 9 launches from there and then work to convert Pad 39A for Falcon Heavy flights. Once 39A is back up after its upgrade, we'll hopefully see Falcon Heavy head out there for its first static fire and then launch.
Oh, I can't wait.
Just like LC-40, launches from 39A are heading to low Earth orbit or geostationary orbit, and of course the occasional sun synchronous and interplanetary mission as well. Lastly, within a few years, we hope to see SpaceX's new launch site known as South Texas Launch Site in Boca Chica, Texas, go online. SpaceX is working on this $100 million launch site at the very southern tip of Texas. This will be SpaceX's first entirely private space launch facility, with the other 3 launch sites being leased from the government. Launches out of Boca Chica will have a little bit limited flight path due to the large number of Caribbean islands, Florida, and oil platforms that constrain where the rocket can fly. It is, however, perfectly valid for some LEO launches and any other geostationary or interplanetary launch, like Mars. Next, let's get you up to snuff on SpaceX's landing pads. Something that's still crazy to think about. They need landing pads and not just launch pads these days. So, SpaceX currently has 2 landing pads, LZ-1 at Cape Canaveral and another landing pad at Vandenberg. Each site has smaller pads around the primary pad for Falcon Heavy missions when 2 cores will return to land and touch down simultaneously. Something I can't wait to see. We also need to mention the 2 autonomous spaceport drone ships, or ASDSs. These football field-sized barges are named Of Course I Still Love You, which lives on the East Coast, and Just Read the Instructions, that lives on the West Coast. If you don't know why SpaceX lands on land sometimes and on the drone ship other times, I've got a video for that. One last item that gets asked often. Why is there smoke coming from the rocket? Is everything okay? Yes, everything is perfectly fine. That's just boil off of the liquid oxygen. Just like how water can exist as a liquid at a certain temperature and then boil off into steam, oxygen does that same thing. Oxygen's boiling point is just much, much colder. Liquid oxygen boils at minus 183 degrees Celsius or minus 297 degrees Fahrenheit. Since oxygen is more than 1,000 times denser in liquid form than in gaseous form, all rocket companies opt to use liquid oxygen. So as the rocket sits there on the ground waiting to go to space, it's being warmed up by the ambient air around it, which in turn heats up the liquid oxygen and forces it to boil off. This means if the rocket didn't vent that oxygen as it boiled off and turned into gas, it would rupture the tanks from overpressurization. But again, this is known and engineered, so don't panic when you see a large cloud of smoke or steam pouring from the rocket while it's on the pad. Everything's just fine. So that's gonna do it for part 1 of A Complete Guide to SpaceX's Webcast. In part 2, we'll talk more specifically about what you're seeing during the countdown and what you hear over the radio during that time. Meanwhile, let me know if there's any specific questions you've always had about their webcasts, and I'll make sure and include them in the upcoming parts of the series. While you're at it, I'm wanting your opinion. There are so many opinions out there about me wearing my iconic flight suit that I've taken around the world with me since 2014. If you didn't happen to notice, I didn't wear the helmet after the intro as a way to be less distracting. Now, I want to hear from you guys and get your opinions on whether or not I should wear the suit the whole time and the helmet the whole time, or do half and half, kind of like this, or don't wear the suit at all, but I probably won't be naked. Go ahead and take the poll here and let me know. A big, huge thank you to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other Everyday Astronaut content possible. All your support has been so encouraging. Seriously, thank you. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Don't forget to check out my web store for shirts and hats and prints and lots of other fun stuff at everydayastronaut.com/shop. And as always, all the music in my videos is original. Feel free to check it out and download it for free at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Share it with a friend. Thanks, everybody. That does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.